Okay, so I'd like to finish up our discussion of stereographic projections and then talk a little bit about the theory of work hardening of polycrystalline materials. This kind of last little bit of stereographic projections, I'm going to be showing you the some of the applications. And these are a little bit advanced, but I think that they're it's important to see how you can use these techniques to visualize what you're working with and crystallography. So we introduced stereographic projections in the last lecture, and I said that you can imagine it as a crystal that has a glass bowl sitting on top of it, and if you know the directions that your crystal has, you can map those directions as they extend past your glass bowl where they cut the glass bowl. So you can have your, X, Y, and Z directions. And then you can also have planes. So we can talk about how different planes, these HKL planes, extend out past the crystal and how they cut through the edge of that glass bowl. And then we are going to look at these marks on the glass bowl in this, kind of globe. And you're familiar with this idea of a globe, and you have your latitude and longitude lines that are represented like that. And this representation is called a wolf net. And then we went on and we looked at some fairly simple examples. I mentioned, and it's kind of universally true, that it's a lot easier to work with these if you can have a couple layers and print them on top of each other and have plastic sheets and rotate them relative to one another. But nonetheless, here we're kind of taking some manual rotations. I can get these to rotate 90 degrees or 45 degrees. And then I showed you a highly detailed wolf net that's used in X-ray diffraction and in pole figures. And in this one, the different directions were labeled, as well as the little symmetry operators here that describe the symmetry of a cube. And the interesting thing about this is that, once you've identified your X and Y and Z positions, then you can just interpolate to get the intermediate positions. So that's your, that's 100, 010, then you get 110, here's your 111, and then you can cut through the planes and identify the planes as well. So for example, this would be this plane. Let me get another color here. That plane, which is cutting through our sphere, it has a normal in this direction, and it is the 110 plane. So what I'd like to do now is show you the application of this to talk about plasticity. Your book goes into kind of a very elaborate discussion of this. And again, I don't want to go into too many details, but what I would like to do is I would like to show you just how you can visualize these planes. So let's think about an FCC cubic crystal. And I'm going to be following figure, what is this, 6.11 on page 381 of your textbook in terms of using the nomenclature. So I'll be picking some odd directions and planes. And the reason is that those are the ones that show up in that figure. So let me draw this in. So we got our cube, and I'd like to talk about glide on the, I'll talk about glide on the 1-1-1 bar plane. So the 1-1-1 bar plane, I can draw that as intercepting the 1/1 is 1, x, 1/1 is 1, y, and 1-/1 is -1, z. So I'll define my x, y, and z there. Intercept, intercept, intercept. And this is my one bar plane. And then we'll have two consistent Burgers vectors for glide on that plane. One would be the Burgers vector A/2 1-0-1. And that one we can represent as +1 in the x, +1 in the z, and 0 in the y direction. So I'm gonna pick my coordinate system here, x, y, z, and that's going to let me draw in, there's my A/2, 1-0-1. And now let's pick another color. Let's pick purple, a thinner purple there. Okay, that'd be an intermediate there, huh? Well, okay, I'll pick light green. Why not? Okay. So we've got light green. Let's just make it. Okay, that'll work. And another Burgers vector would be A/2 1-1-0. So that's +1x-1y0, and I'll pick, this is my origin, which then gives me +1x-1y A/2. That'd be my other Burgers, vector. So I want to look at those in a wolf net. So following the notation of your textbook, they chose the 1-0-0 direction out of the page. So let's pick 1-0-0 out of the page, and then they picked this direction as 0-1-0. Which makes 10, 20, 30, 40, 45, that point, 1-1-0. It makes, 0-1-0, it makes 10, 20, 30, 40, 45, that point, one bar, zero, right? So again, we're just kind of interpolating and using the angular relations we know to identify these. Using a right-hand coordinate system, we have X cross Y gives us Z, 0, 0, 1, has to be at the top, which means 0, 0, 1 bar has to be at the bottom. Come on. Bottom. Okay, which means then that 10, 20, 30, 40, 45 is 1, 1, 0, and 10, 20, 30, 45 is 1, 0, 1 bar. Oops, sorry, let me do that top one again. That's 1, 0, 1. Okay. Now we can continue if we want to get the remainder of those lines from our figure 6.11. Let's draw those in. Okay, so that is the 110 plane. And this plane is the 110 plane, right? And we know that because we know that we know that if we have one of those planes, that the normal is 90 degrees to it, and we know that we've counted that each one of those is 45, so we know that there's 90 degrees between that vector and that plane. So we're able to know with certainty the angular relations. Now if we want to draw in the other plane, let's move over here and let's, come on. Let's see, 10, 20, 30, 40, 45, 10, 20, 30, 40, 45. Not a very clean drawing. Let's try that again. Okay. And then this other one. Okay, so now let's use the lasso tool to move those over. Okay, there's one. I'll grab the other one now. Okay, so we got those, which then tells us that we've got here, this is 111, right? Because we know that the 111 direction cuts these. Well, let me draw that again. We know that if we have that plane and we have this plane, this plane, that the 111 direction is coplanar in both of those. And we can also then just read off our numbers because we know we've got our y direction, our z direction, and our x direction. And that means this point is 1, 1 bar 1. This direction is 1, 1 bar 1 bar. And this direction is 1, 1, 1 bar. So that gives us all of the directions that are in our figure 6.11. Okay, so what I'd like to point out now is that if we know these Burgers vectors, we know how they're going to dissociate. So A over 2, 1, 0, 1 is going to dissociate into A over 6, 2, 1 bar 1 plus A over 6, 1, 1, 2. And my light green. A over 2, 1, 1 bar 0 dissociates into A over 6, 2, 1 bar 1 plus A over 6, 1, 2 bar 1 bar. And you can verify that these, in fact, do are coplanar because we have that 1, 1 bar 0 cross 2, 1 bar 1 is equal to 1 bar 1 bar 1, 1, 1 bar 0 cross 1, 2 bar 1 bar. To 1, 1, 1 bar, and grab the blue color again. One, zero, one cross 2, 1 bar 1 is equal to 1, 1, 1 bar. And 101 cross 112 is equal to 1 bar 1 bar 1. So our planes, our directions are coplanar, and we know what they dissociate into. And what I want to point out is that we can represent that now on this figure. And here I'm looking at the 1-1-1 bar plane, and in my figure, this is the 1-1-1 bar direction, 1-1-1 bar. So that means that the plane has to be located 90 degrees that way, and it's going to cut basically through those. And we can check that for ourselves. By looking at if we know that direction is our z direction, and we know this is our 1-1-1 direction, we could say cosine of phi is equal to 0, 0, 1 dotted into 1, 1, 1 divided by the magnitude of each. So that's 1 multiplied by square root of 3 is equal to 1 over square root of 3 phi is equal to 54.74 degrees, but we're not interested in this angle. We're interested in this, the angle between the normal direction and the plane, which is the same as that. So it's going to be 90 minus 54.74, which is 35.26, or about 35.3 degrees. Okay, so I've now rotated this 45 degrees, and if I measure up 35.3 degrees, be 10, 20, 30, 35 right there. Let's draw that line in. And assuming that I kept these figures to scale, and I'm kind of got my fingers crossed on that. Should be able to take this. And look at that. There you have it. That is the 1-1-1 bar plane, and it's 90 degrees from the 1-1-1 bar direction. And let me continue to draw in here some. Let's now identify the 1-1, what direction is that? So this is going to be 10, 20, 30, 40, 45. That is the 0-1-1 direction. So I can now draw this. Oh, come on. I can now draw this plane in. And that is the 0, 0, 0, 1, 1 plane. And we now also have that point, and that point is our 2, 1 bar, 1 direction. And so if you think about it, this point is what's being shared as a common decomposition for these two different Burgers vectors. And it's coplanar with both of the Burgers vectors, and it glides in the 1, 1, 1 bar direction. So in your textbook, they were talking about how the planes rotate and whatnot. And I think that's extremely difficult to see with these, but what I was just hoping to show you was that we can take and use this method of stereographic projections to create a visualization of otherwise complicated mathematics. So that's where I want to stop with stereographic projections. And now I'd like to talk a little bit about work hardening of polycrystalline ceramics. Ceramics, polycrystalline materials. So an annealed material or an annealed metal will have a dislocation density of in and around 10 to the 6th to 10 to the 8th per meter squared. If you cold work it, then the dislocation density jumps up, you know, basically 6 to 8 orders of magnitude to between 10 to the 12 to 10 to the 13 inverse meters squared. The good news here also is that empirical observation tells us that the critical stress for glide follows that of a single crystal in which we have a dislocation pileup. Same functional form as dislocation and here again you got your friction force and dislocation density, Burgers vector, shear modulus, and a geometry. Parameter that scales from 0.3 to 0.6. Now, work hardening is actually a pretty complicated problem, and that's because plastic deformation is not a state function. Not a state function. And what that means is that means that the path you take is important. Or you can also say that it is history dependent. So there isn't an easy way to look at a deformed part and understand how the dislocations got into the arrangement they're in, or even the number of dislocations there are, because they can come into existence and then disappear. But I'm going to show you one of the most common theories, which is the Taylor theory. Of work hardening. And this works from the assumption that we're going to have a parabolic stress strain curve. Well, quite a few assumptions, actually. You also assume that we're only dealing with edge dislocations, and that's just to simplify the math. We're assuming that dislocation motion is uncorrelated. And we'll talk about that in more detail later. And we're also going to assume that the basic picture is that during plastic flow, dislocations interact with each other via their elastic interactions. They become trapped causing internal stresses. That increase the threshold for plastic flow. And maybe I should say these are assumptions, and this is, you know, basic picture. And this is the basic idea of really of all work hardening. But Taylor theory starts out with some simplifying assumptions here. So, okay, let's say that these dislocations, they can travel an average distance before they become stuck. Okay, that's fair. And at a particular strain, there is a given dislocation density. And here you can see that we're already starting to get into some kind of questionable territory, because we know that a material is path dependent. So if you take a part and you wiggle it back and forth, you're ramping up the dislocation density, even though you're not creating a permanent strain. You're not leaving a strain in it. So we're assuming that is a kind of a single path we're traveling. So we've got L, gamma, and rho. Okay, and we know from previous chapters that gamma is equal to K, rho, B, L. All right, this was Orawan theory. Okay, so let's say that we've got all of these dislocations. And that there's an average dislocation length, and we're going to call that L. Well, because we know the dislocation density, then we know that L is equal to rho to the minus 1/2, right? Because, you know, dislocation density is 1/m², so we take the square root and divide it by that, and that gives us length. Okay. Now let's also say that if I have some dislocation and it wants to move, it has to push past a set of dislocations. And tau, this is our internal stress, and this is the stress to push past two dislocations separated by L, the length. Okay. So what we can do is we can imagine, and we have the stress equation. So let's say that we have a dislocation that's fixed and another dislocation which is moving. And it's moving here, and there's another dislocation here. So this distance is L over 2. And we're going to go and we're going to use the equations from chapter 4 for sigma 1, 2. And in this, we're going to say that my free dislocation, in order for it to move, it has x1 is equal to L over 2, because that's the distance here. And we're going to say that its x2 direction is 0. Is it a good assumption? Well, it's a good first approximation, and it's going to give us at least the right order of magnitude for how this works. Okay, so let's get these equations out. I've got sigma 1, 2 is equal to GB x1, x1 squared minus x2 squared over 2 pi 1 minus nu x1 squared plus x2 squared squared. Okay, making our substitutions. This becomes GB L over 2 squared divided by 2 pi 1 minus nu L over 2 to the fourth. Sigma 1, 2 is equal to GB over 2 pi 1 minus nu 2 over L. The 2's cancel out, and we get GB over L pi 1 minus nu, and we can simplify that as sigma 1, 2 is equal to just some constant GB over L, and that is our internal stress. Okay, so we got that. And now we also have the value of L. So that gives us that tau is equal to KGB rho the 1/2. And we have our expression up here, our Orowan expression. And that gives us the relationship between the strain and the dislocation density. So bringing that down, it lets us write that tau is equal to K G B gamma over K B L to the 1/2, or tau is equal to some constant G square root of gamma over L. So we now know that the internal stress should go as the square root of the strain. Again, we're kind of assuming just a linear path and that you aren't doing a lot of extraneous deformation of the process. And what's missing here is we're missing an expression for the internal friction. So tau is equal to tau naught plus some other constant gamma 1/2. And this is what comes out of Taylor theory. Now, it's right within the limits of the assumption, right? And one of the limits of the assumption is that these dislocations, they really don't tend to form a regular distribution, right? Are distributed inhomogeneously. And that's one of the problems with this theory, is that it's a mean field theory that assumes that we can treat everything as though we're smearing it out and it's homogeneously distributed. Another major problem is there's no screw dislocations. Which means no cross slip. And we know that's a major part of dislocation motion. It ignores, well, I'm going to take this as a subset of here. It ignores slip bands. And Luder bands, which we know just by observation that these dislocations are inhomogeneous. And what's more, having these type of slip bands and Luder bands, we know the dislocation motion is correlated. And by that, I mean that you can have two dislocations and, you know, in principle, they can be stuck, right? They can't move past each other, but they can move together. And that's what I mean by correlated motion. So, you know, to within the limits of these assumptions, it's a pretty good first order approximation, but there's always room for improvement, and there are more advanced theories that are used in different situations. So this is where I want to end chapter 6, and the next lecture we will be talking about fracture.